And here a very interesting interview took place, if I might say, with Jesus. As he was there at the well, Jesus had an interview and an encounter with a Samaritan woman. This woman comes up, and this is one that it was not a well-liked woman there in Samaria, but Jesus was there, and this woman comes with her pots to get water. Jesus sitting there as the woman comes to draw water, Jesus asks of the woman for water. Here, no doubt, the woman, the Samaritan woman, asked the question of Jesus, well, why is it that you would ask of me for water, my being a Samaritan and you being a Jew? Realizing the fact that we have no dealings with the Jews, but Jesus realized that his mission was to call upon even those that might be considered as an outcast. The woman realized through much of conversation there with Jesus the Christ, Jesus knew that that was a Messiah according to some teaching of the prophets that was to come. But then here, Jesus tells the woman, as she makes these statements, Jesus tells the woman that I am the Messiah. He says that I am the Messiah. He had been previously telling her about the water that he can offer, which is the living water that will allow her to not thirst and any believers to thirst anymore. But here is an amazing thing. Jesus' disciples arrived on the scene as he was having this conversation with this Samaritan woman. And at the time that he was talking with the Samaritan woman, these disciples arrived back to the scene, and they was amazed to find Jesus having a conversation with this Samaritan woman. So they had chatted amongst one another, you know, asking themselves, you know, why is it? But they did not ask Jesus these questions, but they chatted among themselves to ask, why is it that he's having a conversation with this woman? But here, a very profound thing happened out of the conversation that Jesus had with this Samaritan woman, that she realized that no doubt that this man that was talking to her was a unique individual, and it had to be something special about him. And as her hearing about this Messiah to come, this woman, she leaves even her pots. She leaves them, and then she runs into the village to tell those that was around to come see this man. Come see this man that has told me everything about me. So it lets me know the fact that God knows everything about us. The Bible says he even knows the number of strands of hair in on our head. But here she goes back and she tells. And then she tells him the question, maybe he is the Messiah. You know, and then that hurt their interest to the fact that there was many that came from the village to see this man that she was talking about. And we're talking about Jesus the Christ, the one that had the conversation with her. The lesson goes on to talk about the gathering of fruit for eternal life. The disciples had gathered themselves back there with Jesus. And their concern, the disciples' concern, was about Jesus' physical body and physical food. And you know, I mentioned earlier that they had went into the village to find food. Jesus, he was concerned about him eating. Jesus realized what his mission was. But Jesus told them his food was the work, to do the work that God sent him to do. And we've heard many times that the word tells us that man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Jesus realized that what his mission was to spread the gospel and to be able to evangelize and to be able to plant seeds that will be gathered and harvested at a later time, no doubt, by someone else. So he shares his message with the disciples. Jesus tells them, in him talking to the disciples, he tells them to wake up. There is work to do. The harvest is harvest time, even right now. Whether you believe it or not, even in our homes, in our churches, in our communities, it is harvest time. There are many old saints that have already planted the seed. This divine thing is where someone plants a seed and someone else harvests it. There's work that's done by one disciple, the individual, and then there is gathering by others. But it is harvest time. I share with you that we as believers must, you know, go out and proclaim the good news of Jesus the Christ. That is our ultimate mission on earth, as accepting Christ and believing and accepting him as Lord and Savior in our lives. He wants us to be instruments as an example that he shared with us to go out and to evangelize and to win souls. This thing is all about kingdom building. Good news about Jesus Christ and what he's done in our own life. It's amazing how God has done some miraculous things in your life and even my life, but we hold it on the inside. God wants us to go out and share the good things that he's done in our lives. That is nothing but a testimony. So often we become believers and gain eternal life by accepting and believing in Jesus Christ. We find that this Samaritan woman, was able to make a great move for God because of her going back into the village and sharing the good news. In order for us to be able to gather the fruit, we've got to do some work. We've got to do what God called us to do, is evangelize to those. And sometimes we might have to do what Jesus did. We might have to go into some unfamiliar areas to be able to witness to those that are lost. God wants us to reach out to those and to bring them to Christ. The latter part of our lesson talks about the cause of woman's testimony. All of this happened. All of those individuals that came and wanted to see this man, there were some changes that happened because of this woman's testimony, because of this woman's interaction with Jesus the Christ at the well and the conversation that they had. This unfit looked down upon woman because of her desire to tell the good news about Jesus Christ, gaining many more believers. God wants us to reach out and to go out into the highways and the hedges and to compel dying men and women to come to Christ. In my closing, I challenge you, White Rock, and all of us that may be listening. God wants us to go tell the good news of Jesus Christ. You never know who might be transformed by your testimony. You might feel as though your testimony is very small, but your testimony might be able to transform someone's life, and they would want to experience what changes that came into your life in their own life. Don't be afraid to share what God has done for you. Church, realize the church is the hands and feet of Jesus the Christ in this world, and we should pursue every opportunity to seek others and to find Jesus Christ and to love one another. Go out and find an uncommon place. Don't feel as though that every place that I have to go to is comfortable to me. Sometimes we have to go in uncommon places to find someone that we can evangelize. John tells us that we are, as examples of Jesus Christ, called to evangelize. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen.
Didn't call us for that. Not Deacon Harmon for Sunday school lesson. Recap: call to evangelize. Call to evangelize. Good morning again, myself. So good morning to all of you who are in service today and those of you who are at home. We're grateful and thankful that we're being able to come back in into the sanctuary for our live services, first, second, and third Sunday. Fourth Sunday, we will be pre-recorded with you on Saturday. Those that are able, safely, with your masks and separate, we're more than welcome to have you. Those that still feel a little apprehensive, of course, we'll continue to do it virtually. A few announcements. We'll have virtual communion today following the service. Utility assistance for those of you who are in need of heat and rent and other utility assistance. For Lincoln County citizens, for you to apply, you need to go to the website, the csraeoa.org. It is on the Facebook and the announcement that I posted for service started today. You can find the web address or the phone number, 706-724-0701. Or if you need some further assistance, you can contact Reverend Davis Colors at 706-359-5769. Again, you can rewind that back and get those numbers, that email, that web address. We can also look at the post that I made earlier this morning. For those of you who need a utility or rent assistance, there's assistance out there for you. Also, we're going to get on February 17th, our Bible study in the book of Revelation. The Bible study that was begun previously at the Rock Rock Baptist Church family. I'll tell you, you can find the book, you can see the link in the post again. This is a great study. I began to study because we're they left off on lesson 15 and we're going to start lesson 16. So I began to study. It is a great resource. That book is a great resource, so it's easy to understand and helps and leads and guides you in that study. So we're going to begin that on February 17th through the Zoom platform. Through the Zoom platform on February 17th, we'll begin our Revelation book study. So let's make sure we go ahead and get that Bible study book for us to begin our Wednesday Bible study as we begin. We also like to encourage you today, we want you to continue to stay safe, to continue to practice safe needs, the different things that you need to make sure you stay safe from coronavirus, any other diseases, but also as you study at home, how that you pray, that you get into your word, that you use this as a time of reflection to get a deeper relationship with God. We're reaching out and doing all we can to try to be with you virtually and as safe as we can in physical proximity. But again, today we're going to have our virtual communion immediately following service. Today we're going to be in the book of 1 John chapter 2. We continue our time series today. It's going to be a time to love. And we're going to get in that after we have a selection or two from our supplemental choir today. So we're so grateful that they're with us. But again, I'm not saying this a joke. Those who don't feel comfortable, there's no anger for searching me. I understand. You want to make sure we get this under control before you come out for our rights. But again, we're going to have a selection of two, one or two. Whatever they feel, they will have a selection. Thank you. So we're thankful for Brother Jefferson, Sister Jefferson, and all musicians and musicians over here. We're just so grateful and thankful. Today, as I told you, we're continuing in our time series. We're still dealing with time, and today we're going to be talking about a time to love. What's going to say time to love? A time to love, just so appropriate as we get into the month of February. We know so many of us are dealing with love. The next Sunday, what's next Sunday? Valentine's Day, or Go Broke Day, or whatever you plan to do to show your love. And so we're dealing with this time month, dealing with the time to love. If you can, go with me to the book of 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, 15 through 17. 1 John chapter 2, 15 through 17. 1 John chapter 2, 15 through 17. You find the word of those who are in the church. That's what we stand. That's that we stand in reverence to God's word. 1 John chapter 2, 15 through 17. We're going to read verse 15 together out of the King James Version. I'll read 16 to 17. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, now the King James Version. King James Version. We'll begin it on 3. 1, 2, 3.
Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him.
16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. 17, and the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Let's read 15 one more time together, loud and proud. 1, 2, 3.
Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him.
Father God, we're so grateful and thankful today. God, I ask that you lift me up, Lord God, that I yield to your spirit today. Let it not be of what my Michael wants to say, God, but it be what you have led me to say today, God. Despite my thoughts, despite my study, God, let it be true. Spirit led in this place and in this word today as we continue to learn about time to love. In your name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. A time to love, a time to love. As I told you, we're continuing in our sermon series here for how long God leads us with the concept of time. Today we're dealing with a time to love. And in this text here, we're discussing about love. Love is something that we miss. We a lot of times put our own concept, our own ideas, our own measuring stick of what constitutes love. And many times it's not that we don't look at how we love, we're really looking at just how people love us. And how we feel as if people should love us, how they should show affection to us. It's going to be many people on Sunday that's going to be upset with their spouse, going to be upset with a girlfriend, a boyfriend, be upset with someone because they're not going to show the love in the way that they feel they should show it. And you get upset and you find yourself frustrated because you expected them to give you some tangible thing. You expected them to do something to demonstrate love. And I find that even in the Christian world, we as Christians sometimes, we get find ourselves, same way we get upset with the human spouse or partner, yeah. We find ourselves upset with God.
Amen.
We find ourselves with God because we're not looking at how God is loving us or what God has done for us. We're looking at God while we're looking at human relationships and saying, God, why have you not supplied me or given me something like this? Why have you not blessed me with what I see my neighbor having? Why haven't you given me this tangible thing?
Amen.
And that's how many of us look at God. We find ourselves upset because we have a misunderstanding of love. And a short introduction of love isn't discussing love. The Bible cuts right to the chase. It declares in 1 John 4:8, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. In fact, Jesus summarized all of Scripture in two commands about love. It says, love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. It says that all the laws and the prophets are hanging on these. Jesus explains in Matthew 22:34-40. You see, God created the world and everything in it out of love, declaring his creation is good, and that includes us. Before blessing us in the rest of creation in Genesis 1, consider that God is love, and we're made in his image. ability to reflect God's love in all our interactions. The Bible tells us plainly that when we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. Say love.
Love.
The New Testament, which was written in Greek, speaks of different kinds of love. The Greek words used for words distinct between different forms and intensity of love are agape, storge, philia, and eros. And as Christians, we should familiarize ourselves with these four terms of love God meant for us to express for different situations in our lives. And just for a moment, let's set up a context of what we're going to have in this month of love, the four different types of love. Now, first one, say agape.
Agape.
Agape love is the highest level of love referenced in the Bible. This form of love is everlasting and sacrificial, whether or not the giver receives the same level of love in return. And in the original Greek translation of the scriptural passage, 1 John 4:8, where it said, God is love, the word is agape, was specifically used to identify the type of love God embodies. So the first type of love we're going to be dealing with throughout this month is agape love. The second type of love is storge. Say storge. Okay. Love is the use to describe familial love. This word describes the type of deep and caring bond that develops naturally between parents and children, husband and wife, siblings, and as well as others who may consider to be family. This type of love can withstand many trials, is protective and everlasting. While storge itself is not found in the scripture, the word itself, its contrary form is, the word astrakis is used in the Greek translation of the scripture to mean without natural affection. And we can find in Romans 1:31, where Paul warns that during the end times, people will become so selfish that they will live without any sense of natural affection for their own family members. That's the second, say our second type of love. Now, our third type of love is filial. Say filial.
Filial
love in the scripture. You may be able to guess what this love is. You know, you're in school and they start talking about the city of brotherly love of Philadelphia. The word filial is expressed and used in the Bible and refers to the warmth and the affinity shared by close friends, almost as if those close friends were actual siblings. And a memorable way to think of filial love is to think of storge love, the love between family, applied between non-family members, the love between friends. Interestingly, the Greek translation of the biblical passage telling us in Romans 12:10, to be devoted to one another in love, uses the Greek word Philadelphia in instructing us to love our neighbors as if they were our own brothers. The fourth type of love we're going to deal with this month is Eros love. Say Eros love.
Eros
love refers to romantic or the sexual love. It's the root of the English word erotic. Eros or sexual love in itself is not impure, but it's a gift from God to married couples so that they may express their love with one another and continue the human race. While the word Eros does not appear in the scripture, the Song of Solomon was written to command the virtues of passion and Eros love shared between a husband and a wife. Agape, storge, filio, and eros are the types of love that we're going to be dealing with through this month as we explore what it is and how it is a time of love. Say time of love. And in today's text in 1 John chapter 2, we have the Apostle John in his epistle, in his letter where he's writing to believers in Western Asia. And John in his text, he's assuming that the reader is familiar with the gospel. And rather than restate the facts of the gospel, he's concerned with building confidence in the Christian believers. And at the same time, he's giving words to encourage them to examine their own lives for their size of relationship with Christ. The letter also challenges false teachers and their incorrect claims about Jesus. There are many things shared within the Gospel of John. Chapter 2, where we are in today, it continues John's focus on the fellowship of God through 5 major points. The first point in the book of 1 John, the letter of 1 John, he talks about that fellowship with Christ includes Christ as our advocate. John does not want us to be believers to be sinners, but he understands that we are all sinners and that you're going to sin. And he says that despite the fact that you are sinning, we all have an advocate in Jesus Christ that would be forgiven us of sin. And because of Jesus Christ, he covered the entire world to give us our sins. And he says that those that keep God's commandments are demonstrating that they truly know Christ. And it says that those who do not keep God's commandment, they show that they have no fellowship with him.
Amen.
He also tells them about if you say that you are not a sinner, that you are a liar. And he tells them that those who walk in Christ, as Christ will give evidence that they are in him. The second thing we find in the book of 2 John is that believers are commanded to love one another. Say love one another. This, he says in 1 John 2 and 7 that this is not a new commandment, but one given from the beginning by Christ. He says that hate for one's spiritual brother or sister is incompatible with the fellowship of Christ. Love is often defined as the single most important sign in which word is used to identify a Christian. Those who love their fellow brother and sister, he says that they are in the light. And we got to understand when these first two things that he's talking about in the book, that he's saying that, yes, you are a sinner, but you have an advocate in Jesus Christ who died for your sins. And then just confess that you are a sinner and understanding that if you don't walk in the light, if you don't walk in the light and have love for your fellow brothers and sisters, then you are not none of God's. Those are some important things that John is talking about. If you say you love God, then you're going to show love. You can't say we love God and not love our fellow brothers and sisters.
Amen.
Now, I understand it's difficult at times to want to love some people because you may not like people. It didn't say that you have to like everyone, but it does tell us we need to love everyone. There are some people that are going to do you wrong, but guess what? We must still love them.
Amen.
If we call ourselves a fellow brother, sister, Christian in Christ, there are some people that may do you wrong, but guess what? You must still love them. There are some people that may try to tear you down, but guess what? You may still have to love them. There are some people that may scandalize your name, but guess what? We still have to love them.
Amen.
There are some people that may do some harm to you, but guess what? We still must love them.
Yeah.
And John is telling us in this letter, he's talking to these Christians in Western Asia, and understanding that to be a Christian, to say that you love God, you must demonstrate some love. And I'm coming to you today to let you know that it is a time for us to demonstrate that love. If we're going to call ourselves Christians, it is time for us to demonstrate love. If we're going to call ourselves a fellow believer in Jesus Christ, we must demonstrate that love. John is telling that we must demonstrate that love. I'm trying to tell you that we must demonstrate that love. And the love we must demonstrate is the love that God demonstrates towards us. Because it's going to tell us in verse number 15 in our text today. It says that believers are not to love the world. Say love the world.
Love the world.
It refers to those who love the world and our spiritual things to godly things. The world phrase in this context of verse 15 is used often to refer to the simple material things of this world.
Uh-huh.
And it says that those who love the world are more than Christ. The love of the Father is not in them. 1 John 2 and 15, our main scripture for today. Again, we have these words right here, where it says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And 17, and the world passes away and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of the God abideth forever. And we find that it tells them that if you want to demonstrate that you love God, you must love God more than you love the world. We must love God more than we love material possessions. We must love God more than we love our selfish desires. We must love God more than we want to satisfy the flesh. We must love God more than we must want to satisfy the lust of our eyes. We must love God more than we love the things of this world. We must love God more than material possessions. We must love God more than we satisfy the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Because if we say that we are a Christian, if we say that we are a Christian, as John is trying to teach them, and I'm trying to teach you, it is time to show that you must demonstrate some love. Because it says you can't love the world rather than the thing. You must not love the world. But I tell you, when I read this text, and I begin to think about some things now, I do have to pause for a minute before we close the sermon out today, where it says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. But then when I go to John 3:16, I find something here. In John 6:20, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Yeah.
For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And so I'm going to say that again. In First John, it tells me, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. But then when I go to John 3:16, it says, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And I'm beginning to think here, but even our English language, when we just see the word world, we think that it don't mean the same thing. But when he's telling us not to love the world, he's talking about the things that are in the world. But when God is saying that he loved the world, he's talking about the people of the world. And because of John 17, it says this, I have given them thy word, and the world have hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that I should take them out of the world, but I should keep them from evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. And what I'm getting to here is trying to get you to understand is that he's telling us that we should not love the materialistic things of the world. But God said that he did come for the world, and the world that he came for is the people of the world. That's you and I, us sinners, the people that in need of his grace and his mercy. Because we gotta find that we must live in the world, but not be a part of the world. We can be a part of the physical world, but we can't be in the worldly mindset. We can't follow the carnal mindset in our world. Because if we find that, we'll find the love of the Father is not in us. We'll find that we're just a Christian in name only. And in this time that was going on, there were many people that were Christian or in name only. That in this time, it was around 50 or 60 years after Christianity had just got formed when he was writing this letter. And there were some people that were trying to take the word of God and twist some things around. They were taking some teachings of God and twisting it around. But John is trying to get them to understand. He tells them, my dear children, my children, my elders, my people that are in between, that you must not love the things of this world, but you must love the people in this world. And as I come to a close, I got a demonstration of how we must love the world. You want to move that iPad? Somebody for me to follow me. Because here's the thing here. And so here's the thing. It's like getting up on this ladder. It's like getting up on this ladder. Because in verse number 16, it talks about the pride of life. It says that if you have the pride of life, and that's how it is sometimes in our life, it's like when I'm climbing up this ladder, the first thing that gets me and draws me away from God is the pride of life. The pride of life is when I think about the outward appearance and I want to impress someone by what I have. It's the pride of life. I think about Eve when she was in the garden. And one thing that got her to where she sinned is because of the pride of life. Because the devil told her that in the knowledge of good and evil, if she ate of the fruit, then she'll gain knowledge and wisdom. And that's how many of us, that the devil is trying to trick us and give us some things that we see. He's trying to give us some things and say, if you get this, you're going to get that. If you get this, I'm going to lift you up. If you get this, I'm going to make you in charge of this. If you just follow me, I'm going to lift you up in the world. And that's the first thing that we find that he talks about that separates you from God. Because when you're trying to follow the pride of life, the lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh, like John is talking about in 1 John 2:15 through 17, you find yourself that you begin to take a step further away from God. And I'm trying to tell you that you need to stop taking steps further away from God. The second thing is, we get the lust of the eyes. The lust of the eyes. You know what that is? The lust of the eyes. There's so many things that cause us trying to get the lust of the eyes. I know some of you young folks out there, you're looking at the silhouette channel. When you look at the silhouette channel, what is it all about? It's all about trying to capture our eyes. I think about other things they're trying to capture on Facebook and Instagram and TikTok is when people are trying to do the blessing challenge. Those are things that are trying to get the lust of your eyes. Things that are trying to draw you away. And that's what happens when it says that you don't have the love of God in you because you are letting the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes lead you. I think of Eve when she had the lust of the eyes because the serpent told her and it said that the Bible tells us that it looked good to her. It pleased her eyes. And that's the way we get drawn away from God. We take steps further and further from God because we let the lust of our eyes lead us and guide us. The third thing it talks about in verse 16 is the lust of the flesh. You know what the lust of the flesh is? What feels good to me. And we find ourselves, we take another step further away from God because what is leading us? The lust of the flesh. I can't deny myself because I want that. That woman looks good, I'm going to take some of that. That man looks good, I'm going to get with him. I want to have money, I'm going to rob somebody. I should not be eating this, but I'm going to eat it anyway. I know things that need to help lift my body up. We know the things that we need spiritually to lift our body up. But we have difficult times because we don't want to deny the flesh. We don't want to deny our flesh. The flesh is just that our eyes want to look at TV, but the Spirit is saying you need to get into the Word. I don't think we can't do that because we're getting further and further away from God. When we get further away from God, we will find out something. Now, as I was stepping up here, there were some warnings right here. On the top of this ladder, there's a warning that says caution, a warning. If I get too high, here we are. If I get too far away from God, then I'm going to find myself in a dangerous situation. I have no one supporting me up here. I'm trying to get further and further up in the world. But the further and further up in the world I go, guess what? I find myself on shaky ground. I'm finding myself like a foolish builder who built this house on the sand. Because when the rain came, when the storm came, when the wind blew, you find that things get a little tricky and it blew it down. And that's what happens when you try to build your life on the love of the world. That you find yourself, you think you are good, you think you're doing good, but then storms come, but then some disaster come, and you have nothing to be solid on. You find yourself that you find yourself, things get rocky, things get, and I have nobody to help me. And then like that foolish mirror, I find myself, it falls down. It falls down with a giant crush. But here's the thing that happens. Here's the thing that happens. Bring up that camera with me. Bring that camera right here. Here's the thing that happens. But I tell you, when I get on that thing right there, that's what I'm saying. But the thing of it, I ain't even like a wise builder that built it on a solid foundation, that built his house on a solid foundation. And we must build our relationship with God on a solid foundation. Because I can step up in the world, but I have God with me. When I step up in God, I got my Father. I got the Son and I got the Holy Spirit. And the thing of it is, when I step up here, I'm on a solid foundation. The wind can come, the storm can come, the rain can come, the wind can come, situations can come, sickness can come, death can come, financial stress can come, but guess what? Because I'm on a solid foundation, I'm on a solid foundation of God, I got solid rock, I'm building on a solid rock, and because I'm on a solid rock, I won't be knocked down, because we're on a solid rock with God, we won't be knocked down.
I want a suit that ain't gonna break down while I'm up there preaching.
Amen.
I'm getting in the mood. I want some shoes that ain't going to wear down. I'm going to wear a few times. Yeah, I want a car that I ain't got to worry about going to the car dealership every other day. I want a watch that's going to work when it's cold outside. Yeah, I want a house that's going to keep me warm when it's cold outside. Yes, we all want those things, but we must seek God and His righteousness.
Amen.
And if we seek God and His righteousness and abide in Him and call and evangelize, as Deacon Harmon talked about in Sunday school, by showing that love, then we'll be doing the will of the Father. That's why I have prayer. God, we're so grateful and thankful just for your Spirit today, God. And we're hoping and praying, and I'm hoping, I'm praying, God, that someone who heard this word today, God, that if they don't know you, God, as their Lord and Savior, that they will commit their ways to you, God, that they will accept you as their Lord and Savior, believe that you died on the cross on the line, resurrect for us, God, and they'll confess that they're a sinner in need of a Savior, God. God, we ask you to continue to just strengthen the banks, families, they're traveling, strengthen Sister Doc, God, as you continue to deal with Sister McCord, God, Stephen Harmon and Brother Crew and Taisha Crew, God, and all that we that are spoken out, God, and those that are not spoken, those that are in need of prayer. We're all in need of prayer, God. We all need your grace. We all need your mercy, God. We're all in need of a healing, God. Touch us spiritually, touch us physically, touch us emotionally, God. Those that are lonely, God, those that are in isolation, those that are in fear, God, strengthen them, God, and may we show love, God. May we yield to your Spirit and lift them up and encourage them, God, as you lead us and guide us, God. We're so grateful and thankful for your people, God. It's in your name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You can get a time to cool off a little bit, and we're going to come back in about 5 minutes with communion again. If you don't have a communion set, that's all right. If you got a soda crop, some bread, some chips, if you got some Kool-Aid, whatever you have, we ask that you have that bread. Even if it's water, whatever you have, we ask that you come if you have not got a communion set. As we have virtual communion in about 5 minutes, it is 11:11. Let's say 11:17, we'll be back on for virtual communion. Be blessed, but better yet, let's be a blessing. Amen.